Good afternoon, board members of Kohl's. Thank you for taking the time to be here. My name is Danielle, this is Alice, this is Hank, and Rohan. We're the Fantastic Four, and we're fair dinkum about making sure that Kohl's gets better today. So during our client meetings with Kohl's, there are a couple things that are very apparent to us. You guys have a set of core values and a strategy that has built the success and growth you have had over the last century. And in those, some that really stand out is not only delivering a better store network, but also caring passionately about our customers and providing them the best value and the simplicity and freshness that make them loyal customers. And we want to keep these in consideration as we move forward. So we were given the task of looking at new revenue businesses, and this is due to the fact that in order to sustain the success and growth that Kohl's has had, we not only have to better existing revenue streams, but we have to discover and find new revenue streams. And we were very excited to work with this, as we actually came up with quite a few revenue streams that we wanted to explore. So a couple start from pharmaceutical manufacturing. We also looked into the movie theater industry, as well as looking into ethnic supermarkets, given the diversity that Australia has. However, we wanted to benchmark them against a couple of standards, including market size, as well as looking at our strategic alliances, as well as the white space in the market, so looking at how many competitors saturate the market, as well as looking at feasibility and downside risk if, for any reason, this business venture doesn't roll out as we had planned. However, using these metrics, we decided that meal kit subscriptions actually stood out the strongest, not only because it had one of the largest market sizes, we found that it had the greatest alliance with our current existing business models. In addition to that, we found that there are much fewer competitors in the space, as well as Rohan will actually touch on the feasibility. We found it very feasible and also minimal downside risk when if this venture does not work out. And now, in addition to those standard metrics that we looked at, we found that meal kit subscriptions actually align very strongly with our core values. Not only do we think that we'd be able to provide the freshness and simplicity that we've always through these meal kits, we would be able to give the same value to our customers. And in addition to that, we think that we would inspire customers to cook at home and do more activities together, as well as showing how we care passionately. And in addition to that, it's another bold move towards a new channel and service that we've always pushed towards. So now that I've discussed and introduced the choice that we had of meal kit subscriptions, the rest of my team will actually go more into the consumer trends that led us to choose this decision. A lot has to do with more focus on health and convenience, as well as the fact that it's a great revenue stream. And in addition to having incredible revenue, we found that it has 10 times profit margins than the existing supermarket business that Kohl's is in. In addition to that, we'll talk about the implementation and rollout plan that really leverages the strong relationships that we have with our suppliers right now, as well as the marketing strategy that Kohl's has always been very proud of. And now that I've talked high level over what we're gonna discuss, I'll actually hand it off to Alice, who's gonna dive deeper into the product itself and how we came to it.
Great. So in the process of arriving to our meal kit solution, we thought more about what the Australian consumer wants. And that is number one, health, number two, convenience, and number three, sustainability. In terms of health, 60% of Australians are overweight or obese. As such, in the past year, according to a recent study, 65% of Australians believe that they want more fresh produce and they want to cook more unprocessed food at home. However, only 7% of them have said that they actually have the time to go to the grocery store to prepare and buy the meal the day of. Also, Australians who don't have time might go to restaurants. However, they are only willing to wait up to 8 minutes to be seated at a restaurant. Thirdly, sustainability is very important in this country. 9 in 10 Australians believe that they want local produce. 1/3 of them even said that they were willing to pay up to $2 more per grocery transaction just so that they could buy locally grown products. Now, with these three trends in mind, we believe that the meal kit solution addresses all three trends. In Australia, we believe that there is a $400 million market for meal kits. Now, we really want to focus more on densely populated locations, which is the main four cities, including in Melbourne, Sydney, Brisbane, and Perth. With that, we are down to 250 million in our market. Of that, by 2020, we believe that we can penetrate in 60% of this market, which leaves us with $150 million. Now, what exactly is in our meal kit? We introduce you the Box Chef, which will be a standalone product by Kohl's. With this product, we address the concern for convenience because all of our recipes will take 30 minutes or less to make. Also, we will include step-by-step instructions that will be easy for even someone who doesn't really cook usually to be able to follow through with. Also, our Box Chef will address the issues of health as well as sustainability because we will give our customers very fresh products that are locally grown. By that, we will leverage on our suppliers and partnerships with local farmers. Now, we will divide our subscription-based Box Chef into two main categories. The first one being couples, and the second one being family boxes. With couples, we will provide 2 servings per meal, and with families, we will provide 4 servings per meal. If you would be interested in buying 3 meals per week, then that leaves you with $66 for couples and $132 for families. Now, we want to incentivize our customers to buy more meals from us more frequently. As such, if they were to choose 5 meals per week, then we will provide them with a 10% discount. That leaves us with $99 per couples and $198 for families. Now that I've delved more deeply into our product, I will pass it off to Hank, who will discuss more about the competitor landscape for our strategic implementation.
Thank you very much. So thank you very much, Alice. So now, as Danielle has mentioned, we are at a market with very a significant amount of white space right now. However, we have to keep in mind there are a few competitors already in the space, and we are aware of their existence. Firstly, HelloFresh is a company based out of Europe who has already entered Australia with a noticeable market presence. Their strongest point is their pricing, which is $9.50 on average per serving, which is significant, relatively lower across the board in the industry. However, there are 2 key points that they cannot address for customers' demand. Firstly, they do not provide the flexibility for the customers to choose their meal plans. Secondly, a lot of their recipes requires a long time to prepare. It's very demanded by the customers in this segment. Secondly, we have Molly Spoon. Their weakest point right in the segment is their price points, which is average $11.65 per serving. However, they do have very strong customer service for their products. but then they have a weak packaging qualities, which we believe is due to their lack and deficiency in their current logistics delivery systems in Australia. And lastly, one of our biggest competitors, of course, Woodward's. They are doing something pretty similar, however, it's technically completely different services. So they provide a lot of different recipes on their websites with all the ingredients that's part of the cuisines, where you can click it and then buy all of them at the same time. However, all of these ingredients are listed as full portions, which doesn't cater to customers' need. And it will cost a lot of resources waste for the supermarket and also for the customers. And a lot of their product, actually 43%, are often out of stock, and they also do not provide subscription service as Box Chef. So all of these competitors, compared to us, they lack the minimized supplier cost to the ingredients, and they also do not have the already established local distribution channels in Australia to deliver the best service to our customers. And now, let's look at what are our capabilities in this market that can help us deliver this product. We have a very strong relationship with the suppliers. We actually deliver 96% of produce from our local community, which is very valued by our customers. In our distribution centers, we have invested heavily with Lean Six Sigma programs, which has reduced our deficiency due to employee injury by 44%. In addition, we are pushing very heavily on expanding our online warehouses and online supermarket presence in major cities, which is aligned with our major goal to expand to future cities with box chef. Lastly, we have very cost-efficient last mile operations from the last distribution hub to end users. And we also have mature refrigerating technology such as the click and collect lockers that will serve diverse demands of our customers' delivery needs. So now, looking at Box Chef, how are we going to leverage all these established channels? First thing is suppliers. We are going to increase our demands of fresh produce, and then we are also going to leverage higher preference of customers on the fresh produce with this meal kit. Secondly, in distributions, we currently have one Melbourne online supermarkets which we will do the distributions of our Box Chef products, which will help us minimize our variable costs associated with distribution. Lastly, we are going to continue finding the optimal route within the city to deliver more efficiently and develop our know-hows in distribution. And down the road, depending on our products and customers' preference, we can potentially open up more diverse delivery options such as store pickups or click and collect locker. So now speaking over, we have to understand how do we get the market to know about our products. We believe that P2P marketing drives the strongest user attractions. Firstly, we're going to collaborate with flybys programs enlisted as our partners. However, to minimize the cannibalization risk, we are going to position Box Chef as a standalone brand from Kohl's. At the same time, we are leveraging all the existing corporate connections to minimize our cost. Secondly, in our media promotions, we are going to collaborate with celebrities such as chef, food bloggers to endorse our brand. And on social media, we are going to target people-to-people, lifestyle-focused social media campaigns to get the highest traction and the more robust user growth. Lastly, how do we actually get this user on board? We are providing incentives for referrals done by key loyal customers, and they can offer free credits to their personal friends and families to sign up to Box Chef services. So now I'm going to pass it on to Rohan to talk more about our finance analytics.
Great. Thank you, Hank. So now that Hank has talked to you guys about marketing and how we are going to actually distribute Box Chef, I will be talking a little bit about the profitability of it. Now the first key point is Box Chef is a subscription business. And this means that it's highly predictable for financial modeling purposes, as well as the profit margins are extraordinarily strong. As Danielle mentioned earlier, we expect this to be 10 times the profit margin of our current supermarkets, which are currently operating at a roughly 4.5% profit margin. Now, as you can see, the average revenue is $124,000. And the great part is even with the customer acquisition cost, that is the cost of sales and marketing to acquire these customers, we believe the first box will be profitable. This is an extremely important point because it minimizes downside risk. Even if this venture does not go as planned, we do not expect to lose money on launching every single box and getting it in the hands of customers. This all matters because it rolls up into the profitability. With strong profit margins and low fixed costs, it leads to a higher NPV. We believe that the fixed costs, which we'll go into in a moment, are roughly $6 million for the first year. So even with that fixed cost and the current profit margins of our boxes, we need to sell to 10,000 customers in order to break even on our fixed costs. As one of the leading supermarkets in Australia and a multi-billion dollar company, we believe that Kohl's is the perfect company to sell to not only 10,000 customers, but significantly more, therefore far exceeding our expectations and the requirements to break even. So as I mentioned earlier, we expect an NPV of roughly $80 million by 2020, as well as an NPV of $2.6 billion by 2040. Now, we know it's a little unorthodox to split up an NPV into two different timelines. The reason we did this is inherently a new market. It is growing rapidly at a $5 billion industry and climbing in the United States. It is driving growth in Europe for the last couple years, and it is just kicking off in Australia over the past few years. It is hard to predict how fast this will grow and what the ceilings are. And as a result, with our current projections based off of our research, we are confident we can get to $80 million NPV by 2020. Now, if the growth continues and Kohl's has established itself as a leader by then, we think it can ride the growth and continue to be the leader and the defining company of what it means to own a meal kit subscription service in Australia and achieve this high NPV. So you may be wondering, what about cannibalization? As Danielle and Hank mentioned earlier, we plan to launch this product as a separate company. As a separate product. Boxed Chef will try to minimize our co-branding with Kohl's in order to attract different customers. In an ideal world, we would like to attract customers that A, only eat at restaurants for takeaway, or B, use other supermarkets like our competitors to do their groceries. Now, of course, we understand this kind of targeted marketing is nearly impossible. There would inherently be some overlap in our marketing outreach with our Kohl's customers, given how big Kohl's already is. And so we did a sensitivity analysis and found that even if we have some cannibalization, it will only be a couple million dollars in revenue on our supermarket business, and because of the profit margins, only $1 million in reduced profit. Again, this is because we are moving customers away from a razor-thin supermarket business to a highly profitable subscription meal kit delivery business. Now, there are a couple key risks that we would like to highlight. The main one that I want to focus on is Kohl's being saturated in the food market. Again, as Danielle mentioned earlier, we've considered many, many options. We thought of entering pharmaceuticals, logistic companies, foreign service companies, and we think that Kohl's has strengths in all of these. However, we think that doubling down in the food industry is what Kohl's needs to do. The food industry is changing, and even if the supermarket growth is sluggish in years to come, Kohl's can hedge itself by operating in another food market that is at odds with the supermarket industry. In the event that this meal kit market takes off, like many people are predicting around the world, in Australia, Kohl's will be on the front line defining what that means and reaping the rewards from it. This is a brief implementation timeline. The key call out here is that we want to launch our product quickly. And as mentioned earlier, we believe that Kohl's already has the majority of the capabilities needed to do this. As such, our goal is to launch the product in mid-2017. Now, lastly, I'd like to leave you with this. The members of the board and the employees of Kohl's have done a fantastic job of building up one of Australia's leading supermarkets. We have strong relationships with our farmers, getting the freshest local produce and quality ingredients for our supermarkets. We have a leading distribution capabilities with Six Sigma productivity that is constantly increasing every year. And lastly, Kohl's is no stranger to online delivery and to making sure that food gets in the hands of consumers at the right temperature, at the right time, with minimal spoilage. It is because of these supplier relationships, the distribution capabilities, and our consumer relationships and delivery capabilities, we believe that the meal kit subscription industry is ripe for Kohl's to break into. So please help us redefine the food experience for consumers in Australia. They will open up a box of ingredients all by Kohl's and make a fresh meal for themselves, something that seems to be happening less and less every year. And with this, Kohl's can be on the forefront of defining this new market, and we can change the way food is consumed in Australia. Thank you so much, members of the board. Help us make Kohl's better today.
Thank you very much, Fantastic Four, and a great closure there. Very passionate and convincing of your proposal. Just wondering if you can walk me through your financials. My key question really goes to the heart of three meals per week and $132. So just walk me through how you build up that price and justify that price, and then if you can flow that through to how that kind of multiplies out to your financials would be great.
Yeah. So this is a brief overview of how we got to the actual unit economics calculations. So you can see here that we have the cost per installation. This is taken from a benchmark across the world of actually it's $3, and we increased that by 25% to be conservative. So again, we're using the word installation because that's industry standard, but this is the cost to actually get the customer onto your platform through marketing, through all the creative ways that Hank talked about earlier. Now the second key cost here is a first-time free credit. This is again a common trend that's happening with subscription services to get people to buy that first box. The experience of opening a box takes it from there. Now on the individual unit side, we have a breakdown of our raw materials that you can see here. Again, we think that these are reasonable assumptions, but we love to talk about them. And this all rolls up into the cost of the box. And we're charging $11 per meal, which again is on the lower quartile of this market, and that creates a strong profit margin. Now, how this rolls up into the finances, let's see. Okay, so I know there's a lot of numbers on this chart. This is a screenshot of our financial model. We are assuming that there will be 10% penetration in the four targeted markets that we're operating in next year, and that will grow every couple years until 2020. Now, this causes us for revenue to increase substantially because of the nature of subscription models, in that customers are reoccurring and constantly give us revenue. And again, this all leads to the present value of roughly $110 million, but that's before the cost. So when you factor out the cost, it drops down to $80 million.
Okay, so the build-up on how you covered your costs was clear. Your shipping, if you just go back to the other side, that was $10 or something. That is what? That's the cost of getting it from where to where?
So that's the cost of getting the box from the warehouse where it's built, the internet online warehouses, to the customer. That's based on, we looked online and saw that Kohl's charges between $4 to $18 in shipping, so we picked a median point.
Okay. So this is a reference, but it's fine because you wouldn't know, is you lose money often in the last mile delivery, so that would be one of your challenges on your costing. Mm-hmm. I guess my question is coming from we had a previous proposal for a healthy fast food service thing where we're looking at meals from a fast food restaurant around $11, and you're saying I'm going to pay the same amount or potentially more at home. And also, we work on $150 per week is spent by a family kind of at the lower to mid-range and everyday family of Australian sort of household of four. So if we're spending $150 for a week, then in your introductory slide, just questioning that the affordability of three meals per week for $132.
Yeah, so we came to that three meals a week actually from an industry standard, our average across some of our competitors. And for us to our pricing, we actually are on the lower end of prices for the subscription meal kit. And we are able to not only provide that because of our like strong suppliers and our current distribution channels, but those also add to a better product. And we think that that gives us a huge competitive advantage, not only in price, but also quality. And so the three meals were based off of our research off of other companies. Yeah.
Which company specifically?
HelloFresh and Blue Apron and Marley Spoon.
Okay. My other question is then the 60% share seems quite punchy.
Yeah, so you are right. The 60% share by 2020 might be an optimistic assumption there. However, we are approaching this from two different angles. One is we are being a little bit optimistic on how much market share Kohl's can get because we're assuming that we will be the first mover in the Australian market coming with the might of a leading supermarket, not a startup. The second thing is that we actually don't know what the market growth will look like. The $400 million was an estimate done by research, and that does not include a supermarket entering in the space and helping to shape it. So we do think there's some upside on the market. As you can see here, this is kind of how we got our serviceable addressable market, and this is how we got our totable addressable market. So there is space for Kohl's to help grow that top bound, and then we wouldn't need as high of a capture rate on our market share.
Okay.
Thanks, guys. Nice job. Can we just go to the slide where you've got HelloFresh, Marley Spoon, and Woolworths on it for a sec? We've just got two questions. I think it's about the fifth or sixth one here. Yeah, that's the one. Okay, so Woolworths, we have about 800 stores. Woolworths has got about 1,000 stores. We do about 30 billion in sales. Woolworths does about 40 billion in sales. So let's say roughly they're a third bigger than us. Just talk me through that box at the bottom where you say all of these competitors lack the lower supplier costs and scalable distribution channels beside Kohl's. Does that apply to Woolworths, do you think?
So thank you for that question. So Woolworth is definitely a really big potential competitors in this space. So technically, we don't think they are currently in the same space since they don't provide apportioned meals to the customers, which we think, which we believe is the key to the success in this industry, because we provide the right amount for one meal or three meals per week, which Woolworth currently does not do. They simply list out all the ingredients, and then you can purchase all of them full-sized into the purchase basket.
Right, but you're proposing that we would do portion sizes as well. So mm-hmm. we don't do that either at the moment.
Yeah. So we believe that we are going to, for calls, to focus and launch Box Chef products. And this is a first mover advantage that we are betting on. And then we are also going to stay very focused. Right now, we believe Woodward, they are doing it as a side job, as like a separate tab on their website. And it's also, as you have seen, 43% of them are out of stock. So we believe that first mover advantage is going to set us apart right now. And then we're going to set up the barrier by partnering up with the Flybys programs. So as customers, they sign up, they accumulate points with the Flybys programs, so it creates a switch cost barriers in the future. As we believe we'll do very well, that Woodward, when they enter or they pivot their current products to compete with us, we will have that barrier there.
So the core customer proposition at the heart of this seems to me to be convenience, right? Maybe healthy as well, but it's for time poor families. They get a box that comes and there's a meal in there and they can cook it quickly and it's fresh and all that great stuff. So here's a question. To make that work, you need a whole bunch of things, right? You need a supplier or suppliers who can do it. You need a supply chain, logistics, you need DC, all that kind of stuff. You need the ordering platforms. But most of all, you need customers who are coming and buying from you. You need to scale it up. Why wouldn't we just develop this and sell this through our Coles online platform? So why develop a whole subscription-based model? Why not develop a boxed meals offer and just sell it through Coles online?
So we believe that Coles online, it does not provide the convenience, the core aspects of it, since it's not portioned, and then
We that's just an offer, right? Like, that's just a box product we've got to develop and design.
So thank you for that question. And there's actually a reason we wanted to create a standalone business and not offer it within Coles supermarkets, because we think that there's a huge phenomenon in having a subscription box service. A lot has to do with not only having extremely visible revenue projections, we also see that there's a huge, we would have low costs of marketing because there's a huge social media push towards unboxing these subscription boxes. And the reason we really wanted to create a standalone product had a lot to do with mitigating risks of cannibalization. And so ultimately we think that a separate model from Coles as itself and making sure that it is subscription would not only give customers the incredible anticipation of having this box and not knowing, you know, what sort of meal you're going to produce, and it's like that excitement that you wait on three times a week. In addition to that, it would give the Coles company the ability to have a lot of stability and forecast the demand very directly and not have issues with like overstock.
My question's around, so you've made the call to develop this business from scratch, essentially. Why have you chosen to do that versus, say, acquiring someone like Marley Spoon and then using our scale and applying some synergies to that business?
Right, that's a great question. And we had a conversation around that for a while. Ultimately, our conclusion on that is it's great to acquire a company primarily when you do not have the capabilities or the means to easily build it yourself. We will have to pay a premium. Marley Spoon seems to be doing well along with the other food companies in this space. There's one going IPO in New Zealand, and so we just think that it'll be very expensive. Conversely, as you can see here, we think we have the capabilities primarily to build this. We do need to renegotiate terms with suppliers to get, you know, bulk items such as 100 pieces or 1,000 pieces of chicken rather than individually packaged ones, and other minor things across the supply chain in order to retrofit it to work with this solution. And then lastly, we considered partnering. Ultimately, we just thought that we have a lot of the capabilities to do this ourselves, and there's not much value that a partner can add.
Can I just ask a question around cannibalization? On slide, don't know the number, but it's million profit cannibalization. Obviously, a question around the revenue projection, how many of those customers would already be currently shopping through the Coles or Woolworths? And then I suppose the impulsive buying, which you know, as everyone has been a victim to when they go to the grocery stores, does that capture in the analysis on this slide?
Sorry, could you just repeat the last part of that question?
Yeah, it's really just understanding the 1 million profit cannibalization and how you guys got that and what's included in that. Obviously,
right.
You know, your customers aren't going into the stores.
Right, yeah, so you can see here this is two parts. It's our sensitivity analysis on the top, as well as how that rolls into our cannibalization analysis and what that meant for the bottom line. And the way we did it, I'm happy to flip back to the other slide if that makes more sense. The first thing we did is we need to figure out and isolate how many customers are not going to be buying a basket of goods at our supermarket because of this product. And so to do that, we assume that a customer that would normally eat at a restaurant, that's one way to solve hunger. Another one is to go to a supermarket. The ones that are going to restaurants, they're irrelevant to this problem. The ones that are going to the supermarket, we applied Kohl's 30% share. So that's the potential percentage of customers that may come through our doors. Then it was difficult to make some concrete assumptions around what percentage of them might actually no longer come in the store because of this new product. So we did a sensitivity analysis here. You got 20, 30, and 40%, and we took the average expected value of that.
So it's a dollar for dollar. So if your revenue is 25, like that, you haven't thought about whether or not people, if they went to the stores, they might spend more than 25.
That's true, you're right. So the boxes are roughly $100 to $130. That is for multiple meals. So if the supermarket expenditure is higher, that's not something we considered. But again, through this analysis, we found that the impact on the negative profit for the supermarket side of the business is fairly minimal relative to the gains that we might get. Thank you for that.
Thanks for the presentation. Two questions, one's on price, and then I'll get to competitors. So on price, you've got $11 for the 3 meals a week and $9.90 for the 5 meals a week. So your pricing point is actually a little bit higher for 3 meals a week than current competitors with HelloFresh. Why would customers pay a premium?
Yeah, that's a great question, and we definitely thought that out as we were figuring out the pricing. And to address your question, HelloFresh does not give its customers options in terms of what vegetables and meats and dairy are in their boxes. As for us, we believe that we want to increase customer satisfaction, and by doing so, we want to give our customers at least two or three options every week so that they have an idea of what kind of, you know, foods that they want to make and eat. And we believe that in order to do that, a lot of customers will be willing to pay that, you know, $1 extra if they were to be satisfied more.
So have you considered the reason why maybe HelloFresh doesn't offer that? Is it complexity in the supply chain, and have you factored any of that sort of consideration into your costings?
Yeah, so with HelloFresh, it is definitely the cheapest in the market, and so for consumers who might not want to spend that much, they might be interested in that. However, with $11 as our pricing range, it's still a lot cheaper than other competitors such as Marley Spin.
Yep, which is $11.65 on your page, so it's not that much more.
Yeah, so we're offering some things a little bit more pricey than HelloFresh. However, what we're offering is a lot more quality. In addition to that is choice. So when you go on HelloFresh currently, you have two options, the herbivore or the omnivore. And that limits it to only vegetarians, and that, so you only get to choose from two meal plans.
Okay, that answers my question. So it's a premium for choice.
Yeah, premium for choice and
yep.
Higher quality. A lot of people complain that HelloFresh things actually came spoiled. In addition to that, they also complain that they take longer to cook than a normal meal, and we're trying to sell meals that take less than 30 minutes.
Okay, and my second question on competitors. So with already an established brand, so let's just take HelloFresh as a competitor. The choice is one differentiator. With the others, how do you think competitors will react? And is your projection realistic in terms of capturing 60% whilst there's already market players and it's not completely open slate? There's already competitors. So how do you plan to get 60?
Yeah. Yes. So definitely, thank you for the questions. It's definitely a big concern of ours, and then we are definitely going to mitigate that risk. What we are offering here is compared to the startup entrants such as HelloFresh, is that we have the established logistics systems in Australia, which they do not have, since they are a company based out of Europe. And then based on that, and also our future expansions in this market, setting up online supermarkets in different major cities in Australia will continue to minimize our variable costs as we expand our operations. And also we are leveraging the already built connections of Coles through the Flybys program so that we can gain user attractions in a way that HelloFresh startup, they cannot do. And then if we are looking at Woolworth, we believe that we are mitigating this risk by first mover advantage and being very focused on developing Box Chef to complement what we currently have as Coles, and also leveraging Flybys program to set up that switch cost barriers so that they cannot catch up with us even after they pivot to pursue this product.
Just another question on the financials. Can we go to your inflows and outflows slide, please?
Yep.
You're getting all the hard ones.
Sorry?
You're getting all the hard questions. Okay, so year one of this model, if I read this page, you're saying GP of about 11 million, discounted back to 10. Is it discounted cost? I'm just trying to work out what's the net cash flow in year one, sorry. So, is it 11 or is it 11 minus your 5.7 down the bottom?
So it's discounted back at 10%, so that'd be the discounted profit, and then we also subtracted the discounted costs that would be incurred. So the net is actually not listed here because we rolled it up, but it would
right.
be
so year one cash flow is like 5, right?
Yeah.
Is that right? Okay. Yeah. So you go 5 and then the next year you're 15 and growing and growing.
Right, exactly.
So 5 on 25, so call it about 20%. Let's say free cash flow as a proportion of sales, right? So here's the interesting thing. There is virtually no grocery retailers around the world who can make online profitable. And the reason is the costs, it's so prohibitive relative to the sales that you get back from it. So I'm just interested in your model. What is it that you think is different from an online perspective that whether it's the premium you trade, the premium that you're getting from the customer or your lower cost of service, it would enable you to do something that grocery retailing has found
right.
globally.
Definitely. No, thank you for that. So these are our preliminary analysis of costs, and yes, they may flex a little bit as we go forward and do more analysis on this. But I think the key answer to your question is, how many grocery supermarkets have genuinely tried to enter the meal kit space? This is something that's just being defined in the US and in Europe. We know Whole Foods has said on an earnings call that the CEO is interested in moving in this space in the US, although he's keeping that under wraps. So the answer is the unit economics of it. The unit economics of delivering a loaf of bread and the rest of my grocery bag through the current Coles online supermarket and all the other competitors or supermarkets internationally, I am willing to bet is not as favorable as a subscription model where you can charge a premium, as we said earlier, because of the selection of choice, and again, is on an ongoing, reoccurring basis. And I think that's the key to why we expect this profitability to be a lot stronger. And the exciting part is it hasn't been done by a supermarket yet. So this is a great opportunity for Coles to get in there and steal some of the market share locally away from Blue Apron, who's going IPO next year at $3 billion, and HelloFresh has been growing like a weed, that are entering this market.
Yeah, that's a good answer. If we go back to individual unit cost slide, your slide numbers.
Yeah. This one or the first one?
Yeah, this one.
Okay.
So what's in your raw food materials, your $48? What is included in that?
Yeah, so that's included.
$65.